So now it's the last lecture about this introduction to partially hyperbolic dynamics. So in this last lecture, I like to present more works in progress and so perspectives, and to concentrate more on attractors, as Raphael already did in the morning. So maybe dynamics of partially hyperbolic attractors. So let's summarize what we say up to here. So we consider a diffeomorphism which is partially hyperbolic. So this means that there is a filtration, so a sequence of trapping region, a nested sequence. So they are trapping. And then the maximal invariant set between consecutive trapping regions, so the maximal invariant set in ui plus 1 minus ui is partially hyperbolic. So either it is a sink or a source, so just a periodic point, or it has dominated splitting. With non-trivial contracted and expanded bundles and some center part which splits into one-dimensional bundles. So this notion of partial hyperbolicity is what happens when F is far from homoclinic tangencies. So this is the dynamics that we expect to be not too wild, and that we want to describe. So the main problem that we addressed, that we discussed, so the one that Raphael discussed this morning was, so up to consider a subclass, but which is dense, so we'd like to know if there is an open set but dense containing the set of partially hyperbolic system such that for this system the dynamics in general splits into classes, chain recurrent classes, and here we want to say that the chain recurrent classes are finite, or finitely many one. And then maybe it's possible to describe more the dynamics inside those classes. So properties of these classes. Let's call C such a class. So what Raphael discussed yesterday was about the transitivity. But one may address many questions. Here we are more qualitative, so a question that we want to know is, for instance, if we have a periodic point. But then you may do ergodic theory. And so today, this afternoon, to conclude, I'd like to say more about this property, what we expect about this one. Just to say that among these classes, there are several cases, so basically three cases, So the first case occurs when the class is a whole manifold. It's a chain transitive case. So this is exactly what Raphael discussed yesterday. Then we have the case C is an intersection of trapping region, so it is a quasi-attractor. You may think it is a, okay, C is a quasi-attractor. Among them you have attractors. And the last case, so the other case, let's say that C is a saddle type. That we understand less. So I'd like mainly to discuss this case. So this morning, Raphael told you that so there is a better class, which is a class, the center here only has one bundle. And so let's restrict to this class, in which case Raphael said that the number of quasi-attractors is finite. So we'd like to say more about this attractor and discuss in particular the transitivity in this case. Yesterday it was discussed the transitivity in the case there is only one quasi-attractor, which is a whole manifold. Now we would like to see what happens when there are several ones. Okay, so as I said, it's more a work in progress. With Raphael. So let me start with something more classical, so about what we would like to say. So about the dynamics inside an attractor, we didn't discuss up to here so much about the periodic point, so now let's do it. So about the periodic structure on the class. So we have a notion of that is called homoclinic class. This is defined as follows. So you take two periodic points and you assume they are hyperbolic. And you say that they are homoclinically related. If there are orbits which go from P to Q and from Q to P. So if the unstable manifold of the orbit of P has a transverse intersection with the stable manifold of the orbit of Q and the converse also. And then the homoclinic class of P is the closure of the set of periodic points homoclinically related to P. So there are many nice properties. I won't detail them, so just to mention. This relation is an equivalence relation. So if P and Q are homoclinically related, both homoclinic classes are the same. And H of P can also be obtained as the closure of the transverse intersection between its stable and unstable manifold. Transverse. And from that, we can deduce that the dynamics on the class is transitive. So all of this property are nice consequences of hyperbolic properties of hyperbolic sets, huh? Because so for instance, to show the equivalence relation, you have P, you have Q, the unstable manifold of P intersects the stable manifold of Q, and Q is related to another one, R. And then there is a property called the lambda lemma, which tells you that when you look to the global unstable manifold of P, it accumulates to the unstable manifold of Q, and then will intersect transversally the stable manifold of R. So you may prove that. And just with this lemma, you will get most of this. Okay, so one thing I would like to do is to compare a chain recurrent class with the homoclinic classes, which in principle are smaller because they are transitive. Does this occur in general? And does it occur frequently or robustly? So there are cases where it's the case. Well, the answer is yes. So we discussed about many examples. And I will show you that for many examples, so non-hyperbolic dynamics, which is robustly transitive, in fact, the whole manifold is a homoclinic class. So for many examples, remember, you start with a three torus. You have a hyperbolic automorphism acting on the three torus with three real eigenvalues. And you deform it, keeping the splitting. And so Raphael explained that it's possible to get something robustly transitive. So what I would like to add is the fact that so under the property he told you, for F, the whole manifold is a homoclinic class. So the proof is very similar to the proof of the robust transitivity. So let me say it shortly. So we have a fixed point. So with one stable manifold and a two-dimensional unstable manifold with a strong direction. And now to show that, we have to look to the unstable manifold, the stable manifold, and to try to find a transverse intersection near any point. So you pick Z here, and you'd like to find a transverse intersection near Z. So what you can do is to look to, so you want, you take a ball, a neighborhood of Z, and then you take the stable manifold of Z, the strong stable manifold of Z, and you iterate backwards, so it expands, it gets so it attains a macroscopic size, and eventually it will intersect this stable manifold. So then you iterate backwards, forward again, and so you bring this unstable manifold of P now close to Z, because this stable manifold gets shrink. So this is part of the unstable manifold of P. And now you iterate forward this disk, and you use a property called SH property. So Raphael explained that yesterday, which gives you some expansion at some point in the future. So this is F, FL of D. And once it's large enough, it will meet the stable manifold of P. So then you iterate backwards again, and this point comes here. So you find a transverse intersection between stable and unstable manifold of the orbit of P. And here, I used only properties that are robust. So now I'd like to say a bit more about the classes. So not only we may have a good structure, so filled it with periodic points that are linked together, but sometimes one can recover a weak hyperbolicity, because remember, when you're partially hyperbolic in the center, you don't know anything. So you want to say something which is maybe more topological. So let me introduce the notion of chain hyperbolic class. Okay, so now we consider a Hobokleinic class. So the setting is a bit more general, with a domination. And we assume that there are two Plagues family. That are tangent to E and F. Okay. Usually I say locally invariant, but here it's better. We assume that they are trapped. So the first one is trapped in the future. So the image of a Plague is sent into the Plague at the image. Strictly, so let's assume the thing you have disk, open disk, and the second one is trapped in the past. Okay. And then, so you don't know about the size of this flake. Maybe it's given, so maybe it's large and too large compared to what happens on the class. So you want to link this flake to the class. So what you assume furthermore is that for P, the plaque along E for P is contained in a stable manifold of P, and the plaque for F at P is contained in the unstable manifold of P. So here, the dimension of fibers of E correspond to the stable dimension of P. And under these properties, one gets some of the usual good hyperbolic properties, qualitative properties. So so you may imagine that these plaques are like local stable manifold and local unstable manifold, but in a weaker sense. So what you get is that for any point x, dE of x is in the, you would like the stable set of the class. Here you have the chain stable set. This means that for any y in the plaque, and for any epsilon, there is an epsilon pseudo orbit between y and some point in the class, so p if you want, or x. And in the same way, the other plaque is in the chain stable set for f minus 1. Let's say chain unstable set of the class. So in particular, for any two-point clause, you have a local product structure. So the two plaques intersect transversely. At a unique point, and so from that you deduce that the point Z is in the chain recon class of P, but you have in fact better, Z belongs to the homoclinic class. And also you have, so this is a local product. From a local product, you're close to have a shadowing lemma. I won't detail it. Just, you don't have shadowing lemma at arbitrary scale, small scale. You have it at the scale given by the plaque. And the last property is that you have some robustness. So there are some conditions. You start with a diffeomorphism with a chain hyperbolic class, so a Moclinic class, but you have to assume at first it is also a chain recurrence class, and when you perturb, you keep the chain hyperbolicity. So what you have to imagine is that chain hyperbolic classes are like a hyperbolic set when you look at a large scale. You see some contraction and some expansion. If you zoom, then points may separate. So it's exactly what happened in Manier example. You started with something hyperbolic, and you deformed in a neighborhood of a very small, in a very small neighborhood of a fixed point. So remember, you had a fixed point P0, So you deform to in the center to create now. So this is supposed to be unstable, and you deform to create new periodic point, and so to change an unstable dimension. But this is at a small scale. So if you look at a larger scale, you don't see this. The MX is still semi-conjugated to the initial one. And so here, you're chain hyperbolic. So the plaques have to be taken at a large enough scale. So this is a first tool I wanted to introduce. Then, now, still the difference with the uniformly hyperbolic case is the center, so we would like to understand more what happens in the center. And to discuss the different possibilities. So we would like to classify the dynamics along the center. So for the moment, let's forget about homoclinic and chain recurrent classes. And let's discuss this locally. So you have K with a partial hyperbolicity. And then stable, the center has dimension one. So a local description. What you do, you don't know, that maybe the tangent dynamics doesn't say anything about the center. You may have neutral points. So what you would like is something more topological. So you introduce plaques, a plaque family, tangent to EC. We know it exists, which is locally invariant. So you have a point, you have the center, and you have a plaque here. So while you have a point in a plaque close enough to Z, you may iterate. When it remains close to the orbit of Z, you remain in a plaque, and you reduce to a dynamics which is like fibered. And so there are several cases. So first, you introduce a plaque family, and second, you discuss the cases. So this is what I call center models. So it's very similar to what happened in the center for a fixed point. So what you can see is this. Either for all the plaques, you see a trapping. In the future, for all the plaques at the same time, or you see a trapping in the past. Or you may, if the center is orientable, you may see a mixed case. Which is like, parabolic. And there is a last case, which tells you that there is a segment of an interval in the plaque which is contained in the set. You can show that they are the only possibilities. This occurs only for one plague, not all. But here it's for all the plague at the same time. So this is what you can say locally, and sometimes you may deduce something, we will see. But then if you want a global description, you would need global plagues, and then it becomes more complicated. So global description. So to say something, you will need periodic points. So this time, K is not any set. We assume K is a homoclinic class, so it's there is a dense set of periodic points. And then you may use so the existence of large plaques, kind of plaques. So it's provided on the periodic point due to an argument by Rana Federico Hertz and Raul Ures. So in this case, any periodic point belongs to how did I say that? Okay, to a curve gamma tangent to EC. So gamma is tangent to EC not only at the point, but at anywhere. So you need that EC is defined everywhere. So if it's the case, fine. Otherwise, you can replace by a confield. Huh? So at any point of gamma. And this curve is invariant globally, so it is which is periodic. And it's infinite on both directions. So both branches, when you take gamma minus p, are infinite, have infinite length. So now, if you have a periodic point and such a curve, you may look to the dynamics on the curve. So you know for one-dimensional dynamics, invertible dynamics, any point goes to a periodic point, and the period is more or less all the period you see on a curve. There is a unique one, or well, you may have a fixed point and point of period two. So let's assume there is a unique one to simplify. So you may have a collection of periodic point, a fixed point, for instance. In between this fixed point, you have some contraction or expansion. And then under a very soft assumption, you may assume that all periodic points of a given period have only finitely many of them. So in a plaque, in such a curve, you have only finite number of periodic points because they have the same period. And so after some so if you go far away enough, then you don't see any periodic point, and so you see either an expansion or a contraction. So then what are the possibilities? Either you see something at large scale, which is trapped again for f minus 1, or for f, or you have a parabolic case. And something else may happen when you build this curve. Well, I didn't precise, I say curve, but maybe what you have, in fact, is a circle. So these are the possibilities. And so you may wonder which cases are possible. So for each of these cases, you may build an example. But you may ask if it's possible to have several of them at the same time. So yes, this could happen. There are examples built by Christian Bonatti, André Gogolev, and Raphael Potri. Well, they wanted something else, but on their example, they show that you may have at the same time circles and lines. But on this example, they don't know which is the case here that appear, maybe several. So this is quite open now. I'd like to give an example quickly where we could have the parabolic case, because this one appears like a skew product with a circle fiber. This one appears among hyperbolic systems. So what about the parabolic case? It's not a degenerate case. This is something that can happen for an open set of systems. So Raphael explained it's possible to build examples so, of partially hyperbolic sets that are skew product that are similar to iterated function system. So what you can do is this: you want it, so it's a saddle. It's a saddle class, so not an attractor. The dynamics is of the form Z T goes to, so it's fiber locally, F of Z G Z of T. And here you have something hyperbolic, you have a horseshoe. So on a surface, so this means that you have a rectangle, some horizontal smaller rectangles that are mapped by F naught to vertical ones. And now you define G, and G is locally constant on each of these smaller rectangles. So you're only interested by points that are here. So I only have to say to fix 16 maps here. Maybe I don't need the No, four maps. The maps are constant here, sorry. Ah, this is the image. Are here. So here you have G1, G2, up to G4. So I have to draw the dynamics of these four maps, so on the interval. So they start with a contracting point and they end with a repelling one. So each time you have two fixed points, and you have to see how to put them. So there are two pairs of maps. So for the two first, I am interested by the contracting part. So you have weak contraction. So that if you imagine you are on the line and you are allowed to apply one of these two maps, you can go to the right or to the left, And since the contraction is weak, you may choose this sequence to adjust an orbit to come to any place in the interval. Okay? So this one I will put after. Then I have another pair of maps that do the same, but they are repelling, weakly repelling. And then since I want a parabolic behavior, I have to complete here with a repelling point. But I choose it in such a way that when I look to all this fixed point, the last one is repelling. And here I have to complete with a contracting point, right? And I want also that the first one is attracting. So if I look at a large scale, I see contraction, expansion, so we are parabolic. Here, this region is linked together because of this weak contraction, it's possible to travel and to go to any place. Here, it's linked together for the same reason by weak expansion. And these two regions are linked together because there is an overlap here. So everything is linked. There is a single class. And this is robust. And so we are parabolic. And this example is interesting for another reason. So remember, we were wondering if the classes so are finite, but also if they are transitive. So generically, they are transitive. But we would like to have also robust transitivity. And we hope that each time we have generic transitivity, we also have robust transitivity. And this is what occurred in the case the whole manifold is transitive. Here in the saddle case, it's no more true. So to say there are special cases where it's possible to get a homoclinic orbit between a point here, and this homoclinic orbit will be ejected from the homoclinic class you have built here. So it belongs to the chain recurrent class, but not to the homoclinic class. Oh, well, I have no time to describe this. Okay. So here it's saddle. So what happens when we have quasi-attractor? So this time, so we have a class C, and it is a quasi-attractor. And it is so partially hyperbolic with one-dimensional center. And so there is a, using the tools I introduced, you can show the following. So remember, we first try to have properties for generic diffeomorphism and then try to extend them to an open region of diffeomorphism. So F is generic. And then you can show that either C is a chain hyperbolic class, so a homoclinic class, or C is saturated by, so is a lamination, by center unstable disk leaves. And when you have such a lamination, transversely to the leaves, you have the strong stable foliation. So if you pick a leaf, this leaf is in the class. And now any point in the neighborhood is in the strong stable manifold of a point of some leaf, so of the class. And so you attract any point in the neighborhood. So C in this case is an attractor. There is no other class. There are no other class in the neighborhood. In this case, we don't know. But we have some good structure. We have the chain hyperbolicity. And moreover, so this is a robust property, and this is also a robust property. Because when a class is isolated for a generic diffeomorphism, it is robustly isolated just by abstract bare argument. So how to show that? So first, you use the local idea of the proof. So first, you use a local argument. So you introduce center plaques. So remember, there were several cases. In this case, you're trapped, so you're chain hyperbolic. Well, you have to build a periodic point, but you're chain hyperbolic. Then the other cases, either on one side you see something repelling, or you see, which cover the trapping for F minus 1 and the parabolic case, or you have an interval. But you're a quasi-attractor. So from a quasi-attractor, you cannot escape. You remain in the quasi-attractor. So here, this is in the class, and this you have point in the class. And then you may saturate this interval, this center interval, by a strong unstable manifold, which are also contained in the class. So you have a center part. You saturate by the unstable leaves, and you build this way a center unstable disk in the class. And so now, generically, you will have periodic point clause. So a periodic point clause has some strong stable manifold which hit this disk, which means that P belongs to the class. And now you're generic. So when you're generic, if you have one periodic point in the class, you are a homoclinic class. By genericity. And now you have many periodic points, so you may use a global argument, the global plaques, leaves, center leaves, at the periodic point. So center leaves. At periodic point, and you discuss the possibilities. Either for all you have periodic point, maybe several one, but when you compare the two last, this length here is uniformly bounded, and then you have some contraction. Then you fill the class by such curve, and so then you may extend to the closure, so to the class by center plaques. But you see they are huge, maybe, and they are trapped. So your chain hyperbolic. So it's the first case. Or there are, you may find two periodic points in the same leaf that are arbitrarily far. So they are arbitrarily large segment, so periodic segment, periodic center segment intervals, no, in the class, and then you may saturate by the strong unstable, and so you're building a center unstable leaf which is arbitrarily large. So you take such a sequence, you saturate by the dynamics, and so you conclude that C contains a center unstable lamination. Inside, but here I explain that such a lamination should be an attractor, so the class has to coincide. So it is a center unstable lamination. And so you got the result. So this is fine. We got something generic. We would like to say more to have something more robust. One word before. You're discussing the non-hyperbolic case, because in the hyperbolic case you have a hyperbolic attractor, which is fine. So there is a result I obtained with Enrique Pujals to address Pallis conjecture, but which implied this, that so if C is non-hyperbolic, quasi-attractor and partially hyperbolic with center of dimension one, then C contains periodic point with different stable dimension. And again, this one is robust. It's true also for perturbation. So not only in the center you're not hyperbolic, you're not contracting nor repelling, but this lack of contraction of or expansion can be seen because you have periodic points with different center behavior in the center. Okay? So now how to say something robust? To conclude, the last step, then you need more geometry. So, I don't know, four or three. You need to use the unstable lamination. So C is a quasi-attractor, so as a quasi-attractor is an unstable lamination, And there is a question we would like to know, that if F is generic, if you have a chain recurrent class with which is an unstable lamination, is this lamination minimal or dynamically minimal? So, dynamically minimal. So, which means that there is no invariant compact lamination in an empty strictly contained in C. If yes, then you may use a kind of argument we said yesterday, Raphael said yesterday, and conclude that C is robustly transitive. But we don't know. So this question seems difficult, and you may ask even in the uniformly hyperbolic case, a related question. Because to show that generically you are dynamically minimal, it's enough to show that starting from any dynamics, you need to perturb to get something minimal. So we found the following problem. Consider an anosov on T3, so conjugate to a linear one, which is partially hyperbolic. So as an anosov, you have an unstable, but it's two-dimensional, and I assume so there is a strong unstable, and this one is unstable. So we know that the stable foliation and the unstable one are, each of them is minimal, but what about the strong unstable? Okay. Or dynamically minimal. Okay, so anyway, we try to find another argument. And so what happens when this lamination is not minimal? Then you decompose and you consider the minimal lamination inside. And as yesterday, you can show that the minimal unstable lamination in C have the property SH. More or less as what Raphael proved yesterday. And then another property that I won't explain this now, but it uses the fact that in the class you have both contraction and expansion at some point, then if the minimal, if the lamination, the unstable one is not minimal, the strong stable one has to be. So the strong stable leaves of C have to be dense in C generically. So this was known for in the case the whole class is partially hyperbolic by well, maybe several works, but Bonatti, Diaz, Ures. And for attractor there is a work by Nobilis to show that. So now you have SH on one on the unstable lamination, minimality on the other direction. You have transitivity generically, and then you get robust transitivity. And so, the conclusion, if I have a few minutes, I don't know, Stefano is. The conclusion is that so in progress, is that so for U open and dense, so the quasi-attractor, there are finitely many of them, but any quasi-attractor is robustly transitive and robustly a homoclinic class. We would like them to be isolated, so to be an attractor. So either it is a CU lamination, and it is an attractor, or it is chain hyperbolic, so it is like, at a large enough scale, it is similar to a hyperbolic attractor. So you may try to find example. And so here, what you can do is to take, so on a surface, an attractor hyperbolic attractor on a surface, one-dimensional attractor, and to do a skew example with a circle that you have to link to the attractor. So you have something two-dimensional, the circle along the center. And here, you may find a topological semi-conjugacy to a hyperbolic model. So there is a classification of hyperbolic attractors in dimension 3 by Brown. He classified hyperbolic attractors in dimension 3, and you may use his classification to build example in this class. So what are his example? You may have the Hull, so an automorphism on T3, and from this one you may open some leaves, do some derived from Anosov construction. So NDA, and from that built example like this. So there are construction by, so here you have many example, but using a DA you have a Carvalho, an example by Carvalho. So you have open in a stable leaf with a strong stable, you have open a bubble, which is outside the attractor. We have a picture in the notes. So this is the first case. The second case, the dynamics, so here it's three-dimensional, the attractor. Now it's two-dimensional, so you have a two torus. inside in your manifold. So this two torus either is normally contracted. In this case, you may not perturb it. So it's only a hyperbolic attractor. So what you can do is to take it tangent to the strong stable and the strong unstable. So, and transversally, you put a weak contraction. If you perturb that, you still keep a hyperbolic set, but so it's homeomorphic to a torus, but not C1. And then you may deform it, like in Manier example, to open in the center. So in the center, you create some line. So it's semi-conjugate to an Anosov in dimension 2, but you have open in the center. And then the last one is a solenoid. So you have the Raphael explained you. You have the solenoidal attractor, and you may deform it to create a non-hyperbolic attractor. Okay, so this ends the picture of this partial hyperbolicity with one-dimensional center. So it was a nice week. I have to leave tomorrow, but I wish you two next wonderful weeks. Thank you.